tomorrow's attractions are here today. This is Preview. China Beach goes back to the future. The season opener spins its cast forward in time from the 60s to the mid-80s. Seeing is believing. The world's largest camera produces a photograph that's so perfect, it's a masterpiece. From hard times to hardwood stardom, basketball hero Bo Kimble shoots for a second career in Hollywood. Ron Stewart's love life revs up into overdrive. Rona Elliot has the exclusive on the Rocker's latest flame. Stay one step ahead as the Preview team travels the world to bring you the first look and the last word on the best of the new.
Chuck Henry in Hollywood, and welcome to America's first focus on the future. Now, today's show has the first look at some revealing photos haunting rock superstar Madonna. But first, Paula McClure goes behind the scenes of a troubled China beach.
What do you do when the network gives your show one last season to succeed in the ratings? Well, if you're China Beach, you cook up an incredible new approach. This old Victorian setting isn't just a change in scenery for the show. It's part of a Back to the Future scheme that will show the cast of China Beach traveling through time.
Okay, this time, say...
It all starts this Saturday night in the first of a special two-part season opener. The year is 1967. The scene is Dana Delany as nurse Colleen McMurphy, first arriving at the R&R base, China Beach.
Boone, at your service. You're McMurphy. I haven't met you yet.
I don't want to have a baby. I don't want to go snake hunting. I don't want to have my chassis waxed, my carburetor tuned, my chrome shined. Yes, I am new here. No, I am not lonely. And no, I do not need a helping hand. Okay? Thank you.
It's only the start of a surprising season of time travel.
I know I'm going to have about 3 marriages over 20 years. I have a little problem adjusting back to life in the States.
When Preview caught up with the crew of China Beach for this scene, they were setting up for a moment that takes place in 1985.
File position, yes.
Father Time and the makeup man have played a few tricks on actor Robert Picardo, aging him 15 years. You'll recall he plays Dr. Richard, Army surgeon in the series.
You want to see my body pad? Here. She's even got a belly button. She's got a navel.
Oh, seriously?
See?
Viewers will learn what's become of him after the war.
He's a doctor, and he plays golf on the weekends, and he doesn't want to reminisce. He doesn't want to face those old feelings and fears and experiences.
But he's forced to, and the past comes knocking on the door of his birthing clinic in Boston. A young woman identifies herself as the daughter of China Beach's bad girl, KC. She's looking for information about the mother who put her up for adoption.
I don't actually remember that much about China Beach. And I'm not very good at dredging stuff up.
Dr. Richard won't reveal much about KC, but he will be reminded of one of his first encounters with her years earlier.
Well,
your instincts are correct, miss. You didn't swallow a watermelon seed.
Actress Marg Helgenberger, KC, helped shape her time travel after she told China Beach's producer she was pregnant last spring.
I think they found it as they found it challenging, and they enjoyed working with it, actually. Because I seemed to be the least likely character to get pregnant.
With all the moving about in time, the cast could well worry about confusing its audience.
Our feeling is that the people who watch our show and love our show watch it very carefully and really love it, and they really care about the characters and study them. And that's our audience. Those are the people we do the show for.
Viewers will get their first look at ABC's new China Beach starting this weekend, Saturday at 9 o'clock, up against NBC's successful seniors, the Golden Girls. But China Beach has some more tricks up its sleeve, including a rumored trip to Vietnam. If it happens, China Beach will be a series with no boundaries of time or geography.
Now to celebrity news. Rona Elliot has a surprise update on the most talked about mansion in Tinseltown.
TV titan Aaron Spelling could script a whole new series on the saga of his Hollywood mansion. He splashed out $10 million for a house on 5 acres, then tore it down to build his dream home. A full 7 years later, construction is due to be completed by the end of this month. Instead of moving in, rumor is he's quietly trying to offload it for $50 million. After all, It is a little larger than the White House. Here's a first, Burt Reynolds without that famous mustache. He agreed to do it for his new CBS sitcom, Evening Shade. Burt's sleeping when his youngest son wonders what Dad would look like with half a mustache. Out comes the razor, and the rest is TV history. Burt's gorgeous wife, Lonnie Anderson, is thrilled because the mustache never did tickle her fancy. Keeping up with Rod Stewart's love life can put you in a spin. The Rod split from Kelly Emberg, mother of his three-year-old daughter, Ruby. Then he was in the arms of curvaceous Terry Copley, who bears all in next month's Playboy. Now he's rocking and rolling in London with beautiful New Zealand model Rachel Hunter. Rod changes girls faster than his one-night stands. Don Johnson's next movie, The Hotspot, is such a scorcher it nearly drew an X rating. Devilish director Dennis Hopper's sexplicit scenes are sizzlers, but there's no frontal nudity. Instead, there's Don's trimmed-down derriere. Co-star Virginia Madsen does tie-up tricks with stockings and loves her men to death, literally. Virginia is so embarrassed by the finished flick, she won't even talk about it. I'm Rona Elliott. Turn on and tune in for more celebrity surprises tomorrow.
Still ahead, the very revealing photographs of rock idol Madonna that the world will never let her live down.
There used to be two choices on the ski slope. You could look cool and freeze, or you could stay warm and then look nerdy. Well, high tech has now solved that high fashion problem. Here's Preview's Bobbie Brown.
Getting a jump on this year's ski season meant taking the high road to the beautiful Andes Mountains in Las Leñas, Argentina, where the cold slopes are warming up with hot fashions. Preview joined Skiing Magazine for the rundown on the latest technology, plus the coolest fashions in ski wear coming this winter.
2, 1.
Veteran photographer John Zimmerman has to be quick when it comes to calling the shots for the magazine layout.
So the thing we look for in our models is that obviously they have to be the beautiful ladies, but they also have to be really proficient, powerful skiers.
Model Caryl Foster has to master the Andes Mountains and stay fresh in front of the camera simultaneously. She tackled the task with a little help from the latest advances in insulation for ski wear this year.
The insulation, the technology they use in the nylons that they're using and all the fabrications really allow you to not wear so much clothing. They whip away the moisture perfectly. You can go through an entire day and really stay warm and feel good and not be so bulky like it used to be.
The crisp white background of Las Leñas, Argentina is the perfect backdrop. Ski wear never looked so vibrant. Colorful patterns together with chemical coatings to repel wind, wet snow, and even dirt make this coming season's ski fashions more than just fitting, they're fabulous. Skiing Magazine's fashion editor, Hollis Brooks, keeps her best foot forward to unveil ski wear's newest technologies.
My assignment for Skiing Magazine is always to present the most authentic, highly practical ski wear. The two-piece Nordica suit was aerodynamically designed. That means that there was no wind that could possibly hold back a skier. And that's why we chose that outfit. Tara Myers modeled a one-piece coach's parka from Spider Ski Wear. It takes the heat from the sun and actually heats up on the body to keep the wearer warm. My personal favorite ski outfit on this trip is the white parka with the fringe.
One fringe benefit to ski wear this winter will be hot accessories. Model Kara Myers demonstrates Combi's 1991 heated gloves.
These gloves are the latest in the innovative style. Not only do they look terrific, but you open this up, turn on the battery, and they keep your hands nice and toasty throughout the day.
With a clear look in eyewear, Scott's Air Force goggles sports an anti-fog system that guarantees a glareless run. Rosignol has a new shirt up their sleeve. The arm extends down to wrap around the hand to stop snow from getting in. From the slopes to the pool, Bausch & Lomb takes the plunge with killer loop sunglasses. The go-anywhere wrap-around shield design will be this season's stunner. Whether you're a ski buff hitting the trails or an expert at après-ski, This winter's outfits offer the cutting edge in high performance and high fashion. Skiing Magazine's December issue will have the full story just as the winter wear becomes available in stores at Thanksgiving.
High-tech photography, the result is the big picture. Literally, Chuck Henry has the breakthrough. This year, Polaroid introduced Museum Replicas Custom Service, a new service which uses this 12 by 12 by 16 foot camera to make the best possible quality, life-size replicas of your favorite original masterpiece paintings. These replicas look so much like the original that you really have to touch them to know that they're not paintings. To make these very special replicas required an innovation in photography on a grand scale.
This is a Polaroid camera. Have you ever wondered what it might be like to actually get inside one of these? Well, that's where you are right now. This room represents the world's largest Polaroid camera, and it's here at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. Behind me, this is the back end of the lens here in the front of the camera. Now we're walking across the bellows, and this piece of equipment right here, well, this is where you put the film.
Making the museum replicas is a three-step process. First, an original masterpiece like this Monet is shot using this 8x10 camera. The transparency it produces is brought to Polaroid's computer lab in Cambridge. Here, the preview got the first look at the scanners that read and digitize the minutest detail. Then, using highly sophisticated computer technology, the colors are precisely calibrated and corrected to exactly correspond to the original. In the third step, the corrected transparency is brought back to the museum to be shot by the world's largest camera, using, of course, the world's largest piece of Polaroid film.
So here it is, a life-size reproduction. This is the ultimate in reproduction. If you get down close, you can see just how fine the clarity and every detail of this Monet comes to life. Well, it's as close to the real thing as you can possibly get. And if it can do this with a Monet, think what it could do with a Chuck Henry. All right. That is great. Only one problem with a picture this size. Never going to find a wallet big enough. Now, to get a Polaroid picture like this, you have to travel to Boston, because as you saw, the world's largest Polaroid camera, it's not portable at all. It can only stay in one place. And the picture, it's kind of hard to transport, too.
But in Chicago, there's a solution. It's the world's largest portable camera, and it's 18 feet long. Brand new, this mammoth camera was designed and built by photographer Doug Bush to enable him to pursue his work in large format photography. Much of Bush's work includes large-scale objects and scenes, whose detail can best be seen using the largest possible camera. His newest camera is so new, in fact, that this is only the third picture that's been taken with it. The design of this camera will enable Bush and other photographers to work in a format that has never before been available.
Well, a large format camera has the advantage of not having to enlarge, and by that, you don't see any visible grain. The negative is put directly to the paper, and then light is exposed to it. Thus, the tonality is real smooth, and the gradation's real fine, and it's just pure detail. And I love detail, and you can't do it with a little camera.
In the age of miniaturization, smaller isn't always better. When it comes to professional photography, bigger is always more positive. Still ahead, a sneak peek of the Madonna photos. Time waits for no one in the accelerated 90s. Chuck Henry keeps you updated with a Fast Facts report.
Given a choice between piano lessons or video games, Super Mario wins over chopsticks any day. But now, a miracle is about to happen. It's the Miracle Piano System, an electronic keyboard that hooks up to your Nintendo to make learning the piano fun. Whether it's diagnosing your trouble spots or accompanying you with the sound of a full orchestra. Even virtuoso Dudley Moore rates this a 10.
Software Tool Works has created a miracle, a piano that teaches you how to play it.
Barcoding, Mr. Ed? Well, trainers at the Kyoto Racetrack in Japan now put barcodes on saddle cloths to help time their horses' workout. The codes are read by scanners, just like the supermarket checkout. Sorry, jockeys, no green stamps given, but it'll help bettors get faster payouts on their winnings. Dennis Hayes, the head honcho of Earth Day, has come up with a seal of good housekeeping for the 90s. It's the Green Seal, a stamp of approval for environmentally safe products. Items will be rated and then tested based on how they're made and their recyclability. By the end of the year, you'll see the Emerald seal of endorsement on everything from light bulbs to laundry cleaners. Instant beer? Not quite, but BYOB will take on a new meaning with the Brew King. This is a do-it-yourself kit for making authentic English pub-style beer. Just pour water into the pre-mixed sack, you store it for 3 weeks, that's the hard part, then you crack the tap, and your brew is ready. Cheers.
Not all movies are made in exotic locations. Dana Hersey went behind the scenes of a new and very different film. As number 30, Bo Kimble became college basketball's number one lean, mean scoring machine. And expectations will be just as high for the Loyola Marymount guard when he begins shooting baskets for the NBA this fall. But first, he's taking up another sort of shooting in Cabrini Green, one of Chicago's toughest neighborhoods.
It looks very natural.
Call it natural casting. In Heaven as a Playground, Bo Kimble makes his acting debut in the role of a basketball player on an inner city league. Due in theaters next spring, this is the story of coaches and agents who exploit young men and their dreams of basketball stardom.
Worldwide now, amigo.
The world will never be the same.
Look, Matthew, let me change your life.
Bo's own life has changed dramatically. He grew up in a Philadelphia ghetto, but unlike his movie character, Bo used basketball triumphantly as a ticket out of the ghetto.
I'll never forget the struggle, I'll never forget not having, and I'll never forget the people who helped me get to this situation.
One of those people was fellow teammate and childhood buddy, Hank Gathers. After Gathers died tragically of heart failure in a game last season, Bo became an overnight hero, leading his team to the NCAA quarterfinals.
I have made it a long road to be successful, but it's not impossible. If you put your mind to it, you believe in yourself, you can do anything you want.
Bo has taken that message on location to Chicago's poorest projects. His movie will be set on the city's meanest street, where drugs and violence often rule.
But for a few days, the rule has given way. Something unusual is happening in this neighborhood. People are working together to create something positive.
This shot. Yeah.
And Bo Kimble is doing something positive. Taking time off from filming, he's shooting hoops with ghetto kids who want to succeed just like he has.
Oh, yeah.
But this movie is based on a rough reality. The film shows how basketball is rarely an escape from poverty, and it co-stars D.B. Sweeney of Eight Men Out and Michael Warren of Hill Street Blues.
All the extras, line up for the big thing. Let's go. Hurry up.
With rain machines hosing down the cast and crew, heaven becomes a wet playground. But nothing can water down enthusiasm on this set, despite numerous takes. And the constant downpour, Bo Kimble remains a sport.
Well, you gotta prepare for everything, so there's a big difference being out there in that cold rain, but it's a part of the job.
And when it comes to this acting stuff, it's a job Bo seems to like. While he joins the Clippers this fall, Heaven as a Playground will open in the spring. And Bo Kimble says he wants to shoot for a second career in Hollywood. On tomorrow's preview, newest technology solves the oldest problem, how to get baby to sleep first time and every time.
Before superstardom, it was a struggling Madonna that was paid a few dollars as a photographer's model. Robin Leach has the first look now at some poses about to make their second debut.
This is Madonna. And this. And this. And this.
5 years ago, this issue of Playboy magazine revealed the material girl without much material on. This week, the entire collection of nude Madonna photographs will be unveiled at the Night Crew Gallery. And Preview has the first look. Oh, boy.
Before superstardom, Miss Blonde Ambition was desperately seeking to make ends meet. In 1979, photographer Martin Schreibner paid the 19-year-old Madonna $30 to pose for a photography class nude.
I told all the models I wasn't using their faces, so I didn't really need a release, because you don't see a face I can identify, but just to protect them and to protect me, or to protect me more, I had them sign model releases. And Madonna signed it, and I said I paid her $30 for the session, and that was it.
The release has become Schreibner's ticket to his fame and fortune. So far, Schreibner's peddled the pictures to Playboy and published a book of them in Japan with a European edition due out later this fall. A $12,000 limited edition of 11 platinum prints will be offered in anything but careful packaging. And when this month-long show opens Thursday, these photos will go on sale for $1,000 apiece.
Do you have any idea what Madonna thinks of these?
I've never had contact with her directly to know really how she feels about it or why.
But some of her business people have said cease and desist.
Yes.
The photographer claims he's fully protected by her signed release. Schreibner also wants to market Madonna's private parts on more than just gallery walls.
T-shirts, sleeping Madonna sheets, boxer shorts, and
thousands of chosen champions for second mortgage home equity loans. Call today and apply by phone. And remember, when your bank says no, Champion says yes.
Linda Lav and Gypsy call 2 4 6 oh 1 oh 2.
Parenthood's Ken Ober and Roxanne Pulitzer. Next on Joan Rivers.
This is the NBC Television Network.